All right, so let us continue with the discussion of photons. At the end of last lecture, we started talking about the following problem. We wanted to consider a source which emits black body radiation. And we wanted to ask if these photons travel to us under the assumption under geometric optics approximation, which means that the frequency or the wavelength is much shorter than the characteristic length scale of variation of the background, then what would be the spectrum that we see? The spectrum of photons that we see. And the claim was that we will see a black body spectrum, but with a shifted temperature. So let me just finish that discussion, and then we will talk about a little bit about thermodynamics and statistical physics. So that we get prepared for the discussion of thermal history. So the idea is very simple. We just want to consider so this is basically consequence of the Liouville theorem. We want to consider some an ensemble of photons and follow their motion in the phase space. So this ensemble of photons in our case is imagining that these are produced by the source. So we have a source and produces these photons that are propagating towards us. So I'm not going to prove the Liouville theorem. The proof is given in the Meissner Thornwiller gravitation book. It's a very simple proof, a proof by pictures, which is very nice. So you can see that, but here is the idea. So the idea is that we are considering a bunch of photons, swarm of photons that are just propagating in a space time. So if you look at the phase space, so I only draw a two-dimensional subspace of the phase space, but you should imagine the full six-dimensional phase space. Then, so these photons that we are considering, they will occupy some region in this phase space. Or we want to imagine, consider some set of photons that occupy a small infinitesimal region in the phase space. So these are photons that are near each other and they are moving with momenta which are close together. So therefore these are nearby photons that are moving. And we want to see as they move and they arrive to us, how they evolve. But the Liouville theorem tells us that this region of the phase space, as we follow it in time, its volume remains preserved. So it will be deformed into some other region, but the volume will be the same. So what is the volume? Is delta Vx times delta V. Let me call it K because I want to use K for momentum and P for pressure. So delta Vk, this will be equal to delta Vx prime, delta Vk prime. Well, these volumes in position momentum stress are measured. So the statement is that the Liouville theorem holds if we use, if we measure these volumes, or if inertial observers, local inertial observers measure the volume. So this is a statement about local inertial observers, but it doesn't matter which local inertial observer we choose. So as you know, we have always an infinite family of them at any point that are boosted with respect to each other. So this volume is preserved. Moreover, I mean, this volume is really defined by identifying all photons in these regions and following their motion. So the other statement about the motion in the phase space is that the region is exclusive. If some photon is inside the region of the phase space, it always remains inside. And some, if something is outside, always remains outside. Why? Because nothing can cross the boundary of the phase space. If two points are at this at some point are have the same position in phase space, they will always have the same point. So nothing, no two trajectories can cross, which means that the boundary is preserved. So the particles that leave at the boundary of these phases, they always remain at the boundary. Okay. So what it means is that the number of photons or the number of particles that we have in this region is also fixed under this time evolution. Which means that therefore the density of particles in the phase space is fixed. So delta n is also equal to delta n prime. So now imagine originally delta n over delta vx, delta vk are the blackbody distribution. So we are considering this original distribution, which is blackbody. So this is some f of omega, which is, so for photons, there is also a typo in the notes. It's 2/2π³ e to the omega over t minus one. So this factor of two comes from the two polarization of photons. So this is the phase space density of photons with frequency omega, where omega is related to this absolute value of k in that phase space element, right? So if we say it was emitted in, if this is measured at the time of emission, so this omega is measured by an observer who lives where this black body existed, like on the surface of that source, and omega is really the absolute value of k measured by that local inertial observer. Okay, but now the statement is that this phase space density remains the same at the for the observer who lives far away. So now we have an F observed of omega. And the question is that what is that F observed of omega? So this has to be the same as the original one, except that we will have also an omega observed, right? The frequency of the photons, the same photons, if they arrive to us through some path in a space-time, the frequency doesn't have to remain the same. In principle, they can redshift. Like for instance, on FRW, we saw that they redshift by this redshift factor, 1+c. And in other, but this is a very general statement. So in general, they propagate on some curved background and their frequency will change. But the density and the phase space has to remain the same. So this is the same F of omega, except that we should express omega. So this was, let me put E here to indicate that this was the original density at the time of emission. So this F observed of omega observed has to be F emission of omega emission. But omega emission and omega observed are simply related by redshift factor. So what do we, well, let's see what I call the redshift factor. Where omega is related to omega emission is related to omega observed by a factor of alpha, which is redshift. So this is redshift. Now, in particular, in FRW, this redshift factor is equal to 1 plus z. But again, we are making a more general statement. And crucially, this redshift factor does not depend on omega. So for all omegas, we have the same redshift factor. So what do we conclude? We conclude that if observed of omega is 2 divided by 2 pi cube e to the omega observed. So I'm just plugging this expression for omega e inside here. Divided by, so omega e is alpha times omega observed. So this is divided by t over alpha minus 1. So what do we see? We see that the observed density of photons, it also has a black body spectrum, except that it's at a different temperature. So the temperature has been redshifted. So this is some situation that happens a lot in astrophysics and in cosmology. We have a source which sends black body radiation. Then we look at it. Under this approximation of geometric optics, it will still have black body, but with a different temperature. Now, one particular example of this is the photons that are called cosmic microwave background photons. So these are photons that we can think of them as being emitted at the time when electrons and protons in our universe, they combine into hydrogen atoms and the universe became neutral. So these are photons that were in, they were interacting with the electrons before that. So they would, the universe was opaque to them, but after that point, when the universe becomes neutral, then they just freely propagate towards us. And at that time, they had a thermal spectrum with some temperature of order of 1 electron volt, which would be the right temperature so that we will have, we'll ionize most of the hydrogen atoms. So when the temperature falls below 1 electron volt, the hydrogen atoms form and the universe becomes approximately neutral and they propagate towards us. Now we see them again with with the black body spectrum, but the temperature that has redshifted by a factor of 1,000. So now we see them with temperature of 2.7 Kelvin, which is just by a factor of 1,000 is smaller than the temperature one electron ball, about 3,000 Kelvin. Okay, any question about this?
One question: what happens when the frequency of the or the wavelength of the electromagnetic spectrum becomes comparable with the background, and we cannot use the geometric optics limit?
Yeah, this particle picture. So here we really thought about geodesics and particles moving on the background and space time. That is only valid if the size of this is much smaller than the curvature length. If that is not the case, then one should just base the wave equation on the curved background and see how they evolve. So then the solution will be background dependent, right? One wouldn't be able to make some general statement. Okay, so let us continue with a review of thermodynamics. And why do we want to talk about thermodynamics? Is basically related to our previous discussion. So what we know that we have some component of radiation in our universe. And what happens is that as we go to earlier times, this component of radiation becomes, this amount of radiation that we have, it becomes hotter and hotter. And we also know that the energy density in this radiation goes as 1/8^4. So at late times, it is a tiny fraction of the energy density in our universe. Omega radiation is of order 10^-4. But as we go to earlier times, exactly because of this rapid fall off, at earlier times, it becomes larger and larger. So as we go to earlier times and it becomes hotter, eventually it becomes bigger than the matter contribution, matter energy density. And for sure, all of them are much, much bigger than, contribution from lambda, cosmological constant, and spatial curvature. So the universe becomes hot and full of radiation. And when this happens, then different particles come into thermal equilibrium or some approximate instantaneous thermal equilibrium with these photons. So the first thing that happens is what I just mentioned, the when the universe if we draw time, or I guess redshift would be in the other direction. So at current time we have omega radiation, which is over the 10 to the minus 4 omega matter, which is approximately 0.3, and omega lambda, which is approximately 0.7. Then we know that at some point, so at Z of order 4,000 or 3,000, we have equality, matter radiation equality. There is a point Z of order of 1,000, and that is when which is called recombination. That is when the temperature of this radiation that we have, it becomes depending on whether we go back in time or forward in time. So if we go forward in time, the temperature drops below the amount that it can ionize the hydrogen atoms. So the hydrogen atoms will form and the universe becomes neutral. So here the universe is approximately neutral, and here is ionized. So then you have, this is the temperature of order 1 eV. So we get to this, as we go back in time, we get to a region in which the universe is ionized. So we have electrons and protons, or electrons and ions, which are charged, and these charged particles, they interact with photons. So there will be Thomson scattering between electrons and photons. Then there will be Coulomb interaction between electrons and ions. So this will be coupled to each other, and therefore there will be a thermal equilibrium with temperature of the photons. Okay, then we go to earlier times that we get to a radiation dominated phase, and then we go even to earlier times. So what is happening? We have a box of photons. Then we are, as we go to earlier times, it's as if taking this box of photons and making it more and more compressed. Therefore, the temperature is going higher and higher. As the temperature goes higher and higher, all the standard model particles gradually, all the standard model interactions gradually become relevant. And the particles, the corresponding particles will be produced. Then we go hotter and hotter. Those particles become relativistic. QCD phase transition happens. Then we have quarks and gluons. Everything comes into thermal equilibrium with each other. So to understand this thermal history, what happened in the past, it would be necessary to understand what the properties of thermal particles in thermal equilibrium. And then, of course, gradually with time, things go out of equilibrium because the rate of interactions become inefficient or slow compared to the expansion of universe. And by comparing rates of various standard model interaction and the expansion of the universe, and also by comparing temperature with the mass of the particles, we can determine relatively accurately what happened for a very large range of Zs. And we get relatively good agreement between what we understand about the standard model and what we observe today, up to some unknowns, which are basically big puzzles of the current particle physics and cosmology, like what is dark matter, and so on. Okay, so this is the motivation. We have, in the past, we had a hot universe with all particles interacting with each other. Therefore, we should understand, remember how thermodynamics works. And first, we are going to just review thermal equilibrium. And then later, we'll see, of course, when we go out, we understand how, when this assumption of thermal equilibrium is good and when it is not. Okay, so we want to talk about equilibrium distribution. Okay, so at thermal equilibrium, basically all observable quantities, they follow from the partition function. So we define partition function and we use that to determine what are the values or expectation values of thermodynamic observable. So what is the partition function? The partition function we use the quantum language. That's easier. So the partition function is, if you have a system with Hamiltonian H and an inverse temperature beta, then the partition function is defined as trace e to the minus beta h. Now, if we have conserved charges in this system, then we can also introduce chemical potentials for those conserved charges. And this trace is what? It's a sum over all energy states of the system. So sum over all energy levels of the system. And then this I can write as e to the minus beta En minus sum over I mu I Q I N. So what are these Qs again? Qs are a set of, is the maximum set of conserved charges that commute with the Hamiltonian and with each other. So that we can simultaneously diagonalize them. And therefore we can label our energy levels by the energies and the value of these conserved charges. Okay, so this is the general definition. For for the partition function. But so here there was no statement about whether the system is weakly coupled, whether we can think about particles or not. This is very general. But we want to restrict ourselves to the simple case when we have a weakly coupled system, when we can talk about particles and a focal space. So therefore, energy levels are just identified by the occupation number of various momentum states, right? That's how we, for instance, we talk about the scattering states in quantum field theory. So here we want to assume the same. Of course, if we have a box and we identify one particle energy levels, then in an interacting theory, putting two particles on that energy level will change the energy compared to twice the original value. The interaction, there will be, for instance, some binding energy between the two. So we are working the approximation that the particles so weakly interacting that we can ignore those interactions. For those changes in the energy, so they are, we want to consider a weakly coupled system. And then here we can talk about particles and occupation numbers of various energy levels. So we have momentum eigenstates or actually let me call them single particle. Single particle states, which are labeled by the momentum, spatial momentum, and then the charges. So let's call them QI. So then the energy of the particle, and of course the mass. So then the energy would be given by K squared plus M squared. And then depending on whether we have bosons or fermions, the energy levels of the system would be just determined by what is the occupation number of any one of these energy levels. So if you have bosons, then any one of these energy levels can have occupation number going from zero to infinity, and you have fermions, then occupation number can be only zero or one. So what about the chemical potential? So now we can talk, since we identified different species of particles, then we can also introduce chemical potential for individual particles depending on their charges. So we say mu A, the chemical potential for particle A, we define it as a sum over I. So remember I runs over the conserved charges that we diagonal. So we define mu A as sum over I mu I times Q I A. So charge of particle type I particle on the charge on the symmetry, the I symmetry. Okay, now the partition function becomes kind of simple. It just factorizes into the partition function for various species. So total C will be just sum over I, sum of product over A, where A is A is running over particle species. ZA. And what is ZA? ZA is now product over all energy levels, which are now labeled by different values of K. And then and for any energy level, we have a sum over allowed values of the occupation number. So the starting from zero to either one or infinity, depending on whether we have bosons or fermions, then e to the minus beta n times e of k minus mu. This is actually mu a. So the chemical potential for particle type A. Oh, now you can notice from this formula that if we consider a particle and its antiparticle, since particles and antiparticles have opposite charges, then they will have opposite chemical potential. So from here, we know that mu A bar antiparticle of particle A is minus mu. In particular, if some species of particle doesn't have any, it's not charged under any symmetry, then mu will be zero. And of course, in that case, the particles and antiparticles are the same. Okay. So now let us do this. So this sum is actually, the sum is easy. Well, in the case of fermions, it's just has two terms in it because n can be either zero or one. In the case of bosons, it is still easy. It is a geometric series, so we can do it. So the answer for ZA is therefore actually, let me write the answer for log of ZA, because now I can write everything in one formula instead of two. So the answer for log of ZA would be this sum over energy levels that we have. Then we have minus or plus log of 1 minus or plus e to the minus beta e k minus mu a, where minus for bosons and plus is for fermions. Right, so this is easy. Say for instance, for fermions, when I take the log, then this product becomes a sum. Log of product is sum of the logs of individual terms in the product. And then every term in the product for fermions has just two terms. When n is zero, where I have one, plus when n is one, when I get this. So that's the bottom line for the fermions. For the bosons, we get you have a geometric series which sums over 1 over 1 minus e to the minus beta e k minus mu, and then we take the log, since it is 1 over something, I get a minus sign, and then 1 minus e to the minus beta e k minus mu. Any questions so far? Okay, so so how is this knowledge of, or is this evaluation of the partition function useful? What do we learn from it? Okay, so we can, for instance, go back to our original definition and see why it is useful. So this was the original definition. So what does it really give us in this weakly coupled regime? What it gives us, so if we take this expression and then try to write it in the weakly coupled regime, then what we get for Z is that it's it's the sum over all energy there. So this is as I'm just rewriting what we had before, e to the minus beta en. And then we had the sum over the charges, but now we can rewrite it as sum over different particle numbers, because now we absorb the charges associated to each particle species into the chemical potentials for those species. So since now we have we are distinguishing the individual particles, then or the notion of particles is well defined, and we can express that sum as the same sum that we had before. Now we can write it as a sum over mu a times the occupation number of particle type a in that energy level n. And so this is the way we define the entropy of the system. So we say this is the this partition function is e to the s minus beta e total minus sum over a mu n. A total number of particles of type A that we have. So you can think of this last equation as the definition of the entropy of the system. Now, if I want to calculate the average number of particle type A in thermal equilibrium, what I can do is that I take the derivative, so I look at 1 over beta times the derivative with respect to mu a times the partition function. Derivative of the logarithm of the partition function. Why? Because this quantity is going to be the sum over energy levels times Na in that energy level, e to the minus beta En minus sum over A mu A n A n divided by Z, which is the definition of the thermal average of the number of particle type A. And if I want to ask about the energy of the system, what I can do is to I can take the derivative of this log of Z with respect to beta. So let me first do the following. If I take minus d beta of log of Z, then this is going to be sum over again energy levels, and now derivative with respect to the energy, it gives me En minus the sum over A mu A N A N e to the minus En minus da 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 divided by C. So what is this? What is this sum? This is so this first term in the sum is just giving me the expectation value of the energy of the system, because now I'm summing over all energy levels, multiplied by n and the Boltzmann factor. So the first term is just the expectation value of energy. And then the second term is sum over A mu A times the expectation value of the number. So for instance, now we can solve these two equations together to derive E equals minus d beta of log Z plus sum over A 1 over beta d mu A of log Z. So that's why the partition function is useful. If I calculate partition function as a function of temperature and the chemical potential, then I can derive thermal averages of various observables like energy and numbers of particles. Of course, I can also determine the entropy by just looking at log of Z. So what is the entropy? It's very common that these expectation values are dropped in this discussion. So when I might say E, but I really mean the thermal expectation value of E. Right, at some fixed temperature that we can have various energies. But there will be an expectation value of the energy of the system. So the, what I mean by E is that expectation value. So now I'm actually going to do that. So what is S? S will be log of Z plus beta E minus sum over mu A N A. Okay, so now what is this? These are general remarks. Of course, I've been assuming that particle number is a well-defined notion. Now let us also use the fact that we specify these energy levels by momentum eigenstates. And let us put the system in a box. So the momentum eigenstates are D discrete. So we consider a box of size L, and therefore the momenta will be, the momenta will be given by integer numbers and x and y and z times 2 pi over L, where n x and y and n z are integers. I'm assuming that there is periodic boundary condition. This doesn't really matter at the end of the day. It's just the simplifying intermediate step to get to the final result. Okay, so for instance, we can ask what is z, or what is log of z when we live in this box. So let us go back here. So this was log of z, right? The sum over this energy levels. And let us focus on a single species, because now we saw that in this weekly copper regime, the discussion really simplifies. The log of z for different species just add up together. So we just need to compute one of them, and then the general case would be just adding things up over different species. Okay, so let us compute, calculate z. A. Calculate z a, but I drop a from now on. So I imagine there is only one species. And so what happens is that but there is not much to this calculation. We have a sum over k, but that sum over k, so we have discrete energy levels because we are in at finite volume. But that sum over k, we can, if the size of the box is very big, we can approximate that sum by an integral. So we approximate it by an integral over the momenta, except that we divide the measure by the units in this, in the momentum space, unit volume in the momentum space, which will be, so for any component of K will be 2 pi over L, therefore the unit volume would be 2 pi over L cubed. So therefore Z, so now I'm just focusing on one species, is D3K over 2 pi cube. So there will be a factor L cube up front, which is the volume L cube. And then what else? We have minus plus G times log of 1 minus plus e to the minus beta e of k minus mu. So again, minus is for bosons, and let me put another parenthesis here. So minus is for the upper signs, the minus signs are for bosons, and the lower signs, the plus signs, are for fermions. Notice that this z is, the way we define it, it was positive definite, right? It was the exponential of something. Sum over exponential, so it was positive definite, and here it is positive definite, because when I choose the upper sign, I'm taking log of something less than one, which is negative, but then I multiply by minus one, and then when I look at the plus sign, then for fermions is log of something larger than one. So this is larger than, this object is larger than zero as it should. Oh, another thing is that I dropped this factor of g in here. The factor of g counts the multiplicity, internal multiplicity of the particle that we have. So for instance, for photons, this g will be 2, the number of polarizations. Maybe I write it. G is the multiplicity. Number of polarizations. So for instance, G equals 2 for photons. So what about electrons? For electrons, again, we have two polarizations. So there will, G will be 2, but also we have positrons, which are different from electrons. So of course, if the chemical potential for electrons is non-zero, for positrons, the chemical potential will be the opposite of that of electrons. So we have to add them up separately with opposite chemical potentials. On the other hand, if the chemical potential for electrons is zero, for some reason, then the value for the partition function for positrons and electrons would be the same. So we could just, if mu e is zero, we could just write four times this expression. So said plug g equals 4 for electrons and positrons, because there are two polarizations and then there are electrons and positrons. Okay, so this is the partition function. Now for instance, we can, something useful to do here is to take the derivative with respect to mu to get the number density. Oh, and this was log of z, of course. So we said d mu 1 over beta times d mu of log of z gives us number of particles. So n, again, I remind you, I'm dropping expectation values. So what is this object? This is equal to L cubed integral d3k divided by 2 pi cube. G divided by e to the beta e of k minus mu minus plus 1. So this is the total number of particles that we have. And so for instance, from here, we can see that we made some statement about the phase space density of photons. And we have black body radiation, which is a thermal distribution of photons. So now you can see it explicitly here. So this is volume times the times an element of volume element of momentum. So we have total volume multiplying this because we have translation invariance in this box. So nothing depends on the position. There is some dependence on momentum, on the absolute value of momentum sitting here. So what is the phase space density? What we call F of omega. Well, this is exactly what we had before for photons, but now more generally, it is G divided by 2 pi cubed e to the beta e of omega minus mu minus plus 1, where omega is just the absolute value of k. And e is the square root of k squared, or absolute value of k squared, or omega squared. So this is the phase space density. Now we could apply those formulas for energy to define, to find the expectation value of energy, or we could just use this formula equivalent. We could just use this formula for the phase space density to find the expectation value of energy. Also, given that we have translation invariance, it is common and useful to divide by this factor of volume to and talk about densities. So for instance, we have number density given by integral d3k divided by 2, or let me just write it in a more compact way. It is integral d3k times f of absolute value of k. And then if you want to talk about the energy density, it's enough to multiply this integral by the energy of individual particles. So E of K times F of K. How do you find the pressure, or how do we define pressure? We define pressure by putting, so inside this volume, we imagine we put some imaginary surface, or we look at the wall of this box, and then we ask, we consider some small volume element on the wall of this box with area dA. And we ask in some unit of time delta t, how much momentum is transferred to this to the wall of this box. Assuming that this box is, the wall is perfectly reflective. So every moment, every particle that hits the wall, it gets reflected. So what? How do we do it? Let's see if we can zoom in here. So we consider so if you imagine particles that come in some particular direction, Okay, so we consider particles that come arrive to the wall in some particular direction along some angle theta. So we have particles that arrive to this wall with some momentum k, and then they get reflected. So this is momentum k. This is the absolute value of momentum is k. They get reflected at the same angle. And then the area is dA. The lengths of this volume element delta L is equal to velocity times delta T that we consider. Let me call it dT. So dL will be V times dT. V is of course given by K divided by E of K. Because remember momentum is M gamma V and energy is M times gamma. We are in a relativistic system. So K, velocity is K over E. Okay, so now, now we can go back to that is that our relation for the phase space density, right? We can compute the number of particles that are in this little box. We can compute the momentum transfer of any one of those, and then sum over all of them, or the ones which live between theta equals zero and theta equals pi over two. So P will be summing over doing the integral over K, this F of K. And then there was a volume element, which was dA times V dT times cosine of theta, because the volume of that little region that I consider here, the volume of this this box is this, the volume of this region is dA times cosine theta times dL. Right, because dL is not perpendicular. dL makes an angle theta with the area element, or normal to the surface. So this is nothing but the. This is nothing but the volume. And then we have the momentum transfer, which is twice k times cosine theta. And of course, we want to divide this by dA and dT, because pressure is the rate of the momentum transfer per unit area. So dA and dT cancel. And this integral, we can write it as k squared dk from 0 to infinity f of k times k times v, or 2k times v. And then we have integral d phi d theta sine theta times cosine squared of theta. An integral of phi goes from 0 to 2 pi, and integral of theta, importantly, it goes from 0 to pi over 2, because we only have half of the, we only get the particles from one direction to this wall. Now this this integral is equal to 1 over 6 times the normal integral that we would write over solid angle. One over six, because there is a one over two, because the upper bound of this integral is pi over two rather than pi, and then the one third comes from this cosine square. But so this you can just compute. Of course, integral over d omega is four pi, so this whole thing is just two pi over three. But it's common to write to keep it in this form. And then the full answer will be integral from, we can rewrite it in the original form if we like. So we can rewrite it in a form similar to the other expression, d3k. F of k, and then we'll have one third k times dek dk. Where I also use the fact that the velocity, which is k over ek, or more explicitly, it is k over the square root of k squared plus m squared, is can also be written as derivative of ek with respect to k. So we get these expressions for the number density, energy density, and moment. Using these and the definition of the entropy, you can find that entropy density is given by P plus rho minus mu times N divided by T. I guess you have a simpler version of this in the homework. Any question about this? Okay, I think that's it for today. We don't need to know too much more about thermal equilibrium distributions for our discussion of thermal history. So if you have questions, then let me know.